carries two programs, one local and one network, the crossing of the two lines can bring unexpected effects. Listen to this.
Loveline. It's time for Loveline.
You know, this can be sex, drugs, rock and roll.
The crowd seems to love this.
Loveline.
Careful, it's slippery. I had a flash.
Loveline.
Only on
92.1
KFMA. Rally. Tucson.
Loveline is meant for an adult audience.
Loveline may contain sexually oriented content.
Listener discretion advised.
Now, here's Loveline.
1-800-LOVE-191.
With Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla.
What? Are you insane?
Dave, the Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is, there he is. Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew's board-certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. PJ Jones and Brian Herta are our guests tonight. You all right, Drew?
I'll be all right.
PJ and Brian were in here last year, I believe, right about this time for the, what used to be the, it is still the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach, or do we have to call it something else?
Nope, still is, as far as I know.
And that is a, man, I keep screwing this up, that's a cart. Cart, right?
Right, there you go.
Right, we don't want to mention Indy, we don't want to mention Formula One.
That's right.
Champ car.
Is it Champ car?
Well, cart, Champ car, yeah.
Same thing, right?
Same thing.
What is all the big names?
Help me. What does that mean now?
Well, cart is championship auto racing teams.
Okay.
And, you know, we got all the big names, you know, Brian Herta,
Michael Andretti,
Al Jr.
Which is moving away from the...
From the Indianapolis Motor Speedway and other series. Okay.
What is the difference as far as the cars go between Formula One, a kart, and an Indy car?
Well, between Formula One and Indy cars, a lot of differences. I mean, over there they have basically unlimited technology. The cars are a lot lighter.
The Formula One.
Yeah, they're lighter. I mean, those guys are running on budgets that are 10 times what we're running. They're spending $7,500 million, where we're, you know, we're well short of that. So basically, that's a really high.
$75 to $100 million a car.
Well, for two cars, yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah, but it's just a different sport. It's
you gotta
kind of think like wide open technology over there.
Why is that?
Well, the rules just restrict them, and in
what
car,
does it do in terms of the actual performance?
You don't see as good a racing.
Yeah, the racing is not as much passing because the cars are so sophisticated, so knife edge that. It's harder for the drivers to then
drive
pass one another.
But
yeah,
the cars,
frankly,
in appearance, they look fairly similar. I mean, maybe the Formula One looks a little different, but the Indy and the cart look fairly similar.
For,
right?
And for all that, if you put both cars on this track, say, I would say that the lap times would actually be pretty similar too.
The cart and the Indy.
Yeah. It's sort of like, you know, quarter horses versus thoroughbreds or something. Yeah, it's just, it's a different, they look about the same, but it's totally different sport if you're into it.
You'll see in Formula One, too, is one team will get a big advantage. You know, like right now it's McLaren, and they got two drivers that are half a second faster in the field, and they pretty much dominate the season. You go to, a cart race, and you could take that, the grid sheet, and you know, you'd be lucky if you pick five drivers if you pick the winner.
Which one of you guys won last year? I can't remember.
High seat Herta.
I didn't win. I finished third. Should have won. I finished third.
I know. That's not too bad.
No,
I,
but he won a race. He won at Mid-Ohio this year.
I remember.
Laguna Seca.
I remember PJ was having a little trouble with breaking in the new Camry engine, I think, in the Toyota. I had to tell him that it was bigger than a 1.8 or something. I think I had to tell him how much displacement his engine had last year, which worried me. But then I realized, oh, he's just driving the car.
Well, they change it all the time, and
sure, like every 5 years.
But I'm in a Ford this year.
Oh, you are?
New team.
Oh, good.
New sponsor. Visteon.
Good. Damn, Toyota wasn't working out for you. So now, both you got V8s.
Yep. Yes.
Turbocharged.
We know that one.
Okay.
That's an easy one.
You got a
twin turbo. Keep those softballs.
Yeah, right. Twin turbo V8s.
No, one turbo.
Turbo. Yeah, oh, that's part of the rules.
What is Visteon? Visteon is a Ford owned company, and basically they're a supply company. They supply the seating, the all the parts to build a Ford car.
And the race is this Sunday, right? You have the celebrity race, which I was not invited to for, well, how many years has the race been going? 15, 20 years?
Now, come on, Adam. You were down there last year in our hospitality. I got you in a few passes, you and your buddies.
I ate like $40 worth of potato salad.
A couple Budweisers, I saw.
$80 worth of beer and $40 worth of potato salad. Now, I went down there last year, and I was treated like a king.
The Man Show should go.
I had a great time.
Shouldn't it? There should be something to do there.
It's not a bad idea.
Yeah.
Can I go down there again this year?
Sure.
I had the time of my life. All right, we'll take some calls and then we'll get back to some racing fun. Danny.
Hello.
You're 16.
Yeah. Okay. I need you and you and Drew to settle a dispute for me and my friend. Mm-hmm. Okay. We were wondering why people or guys in prison sodomize each other. He thinks it's, like, because they're, like, horny and stuff. And I think it's because it's, like, ranking within the prison and stuff. So,
right.
You
know? Right. Well, you know, I think sodomy is something different to every man. I mean, for me, I don't want to speak for Drew or Brian or PJ. I mean, for me, it would be, I think I would go, I'd have to put my money on the horny factor.
Oh, man,
but...
There's a certain aggression about it.
Certain hierarchy within the prison, and it's important not to be someone's bitch. So I think you may both be right on this one, Danny.
All right.
I think if they weren't horny, it wouldn't be happening. I don't care how territorial they were.
Yeah, let me tell you something right now. If we got snowed into this booth for the next few years, I guarantee you there'd be no sodomy going on here. A lot of oral sex. I think eventually we get to that.
You can bet on that
one. Gay.
But, you know, my whole thing would be rock, paper, scissors, and if that doesn't work, I don't know what we're doing. But we're not doing the sodomy thing. All right, Danny?
Yeah.
All right, you have any other hypotheticals involving sex in prison?
No, not really.
Get back to your homework.
But I do have another question for Adam.
Yeah. I'm frightened now.
Yeah?
Okay, like me and my friends, we do a lot of masturbation, right? What is the best
together
magazine out on the market?
What's the best out on the market?
Yeah.
The best what?
Magazine. Because some, like, my friends like Playboy. I like Hustler, but, you know.
Well, again, it depends what your preference is. I'm a big top man, so I like the gent, the busty, and the D-Cup, and, you know, that kind of stuff.
What was the one that Flint gave you?
Flint gave me a subscription to Busty. That was 2 years ago, but I haven't seen this year's subscription yet.
Oh, no kidding.
I hear they got some good strokes out on DVD.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
There you go. You can pick your own scene and everything.
Yeah, they tell... someone was telling me I've not got a DVD porn movie, but they say you can actually move around it and, you know, pick different angles and everything. And people are trying to encourage me to get into this.
Oh, we'll never see you again. We will never see you again.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, it's like, why don't you give me some heroin while you're at it, you idiots? You kidding? You're talking to the guy who, by the way, when he went home with a porn movie at 17 and no projector, held it up to the light in the bathroom, for Christ's sake. God knows, but I'd get lost in my own world. I'd have to call the fire department.
Oh, my God.
That's all I need is the DVD.
It's got the D right there in it for you.
Christine, thank you. Christine?
Yeah.
You're 20. You're on with PJ and Brian, both excellent race car drivers.
Hi, how's it going?
Hey.
Anyways, my boyfriend, he takes creatine and that andro whatever stuff that Martin McGuire takes.
Androstenedione?
Yeah, that thing. Is that like a steroid?
It is.
Does it make you, because he's been like really aggressive lately, and I just want...
Well, theoretically it could, but I wouldn't be surprised if you were doing something more substantial, like bona fide anabolic steroids.
Yeah, he goes down to T1 a lot, so I don't know what...
All right, cool. He's using the real stuff.
It could just be for the hookers.
But androstenedione is a testosterone-like compound. It's a very close relative to testosterone. It can have those kinds of effects, but it's usually in pretty low doses taken orally, so it's not that much prone to this sort of side effect. While the real anabolic steroids, androgenic steroids, absolutely make people aggressive and violent and irritable and depressed. Yeah. All right? Personality changes.
So, but if he's not really on, like, the anabolic, he's just on the andros?
I would certainly suggest you stop the androstenedione.
Well, what's he doing down in TJ?
I don't know. I don't ask.
Well,
you're his girlfriend,
he
right?
He goes down there a lot.
So, well, he just says he goes down there and drinks.
This may be San Diego. You calling from San Diego?
I'm sorry?
You calling from San Diego?
No, I'm calling from L.A.
Really? And he makes a lot of Tijuana runs.
Yeah, that's very fishy, because those other two things you mentioned are readily available. You can walk in any health store and buy that here. So
maybe he likes tacos.
Maybe he's buying tile.
No, he's only been down there twice.
But, all right.
Lately.
Okay. Do you guys communicate at all?
Yeah, we've been going out for a while.
Okay. You're very either very secure or very stupid. I can't figure out which one. But and there's no way any woman in her right mind would let her man go to Tijuana with any regularity and not ask any questions. Do you know, you understand what goes on in Tijuana, Drew?
No, we could tell.
Total debauchery. You understand?
Just a bunch of guys. What?
Guys crawling up on stage, performing oral sex on women. I was
who
there
are the women?
Once. Huh?
Who are the women?
Hookers, the dancers. What do you mean, who are the women?
Are they like
Catholic schoolgirls on a field trip? What do you mean you don't know? Don't play stupid. They're hookers. Last time, I've been to Tijuana a lot, but there's a lot of weird stuff that goes on in Tijuana. All bad. All bad. They force you to drink there. Do you understand that?
Right there, the police.
The mayor stands by the border and forces gives one of those slammers.
Those
and
poppers, really?
Tosses it right down your gullet. Yeah, I was there once, and I was at a strip club, and a giant cockroach jumped up on stage. It was something out of a movie. And the woman was walking down this long ramp, and this huge cockroach was, like, chasing behind her, and people were pushing their chairs back and stuff. And this cockroaches run like they're blind and following some noise or something. They kind of zigzag a lot, and then it just flew off the edge of the stage, and people were screaming. It was great. A lot of guys over there. There's a lot of women over there who aren't women. They're guys with their junk tucked between their legs.
In the bars? Or dancing?
Yeah, they dance and they try. People do anything for a buck over there.
Are these
there.
Americans doing all this weird stuff or Mexicans?
Well, Americans, actually, one time when I was in Tijuana, a lot of Marines and service guys go down there because there's a base down in San Diego.
Pendleton.
One guy got on stage, got completely naked. Got every stitch of clothing off, just completely naked. He's up there dancing with the strippers. He's loaded. And then the next day, we fell asleep on the beach that night. And the next day, there's these other guys on the beach in front of us. And they're giving this guy the ribbing of a lifetime. And they're saying, you can't remember what you did last night, but you got naked and you made an ass of yourself. And the guy's going, shut up. Who cares? Leave me alone. Nobody saw. And so we all decided to walk past him and go, hey, you're that dude who was naked last night. And his friends went berserk. Nothing better could happen to a friend.
You know, I just have an interesting observation, having been on this show a few times now, is that no matter how bizarre the questions that come in are, you always have a relevant anecdote.
Yep.
Usually it's can you top this?
Yeah, I mean, past experience. Yeah.
I mean,
some of the weird things about your jackal friend.
You could be your own show. You could call in and then answer the own questions. We did that.
Wait a minute. I could do that.
We made a book about that. How about that?
Shannon.
Yes?
What's going on? You're 18 years old.
I'm wanting to get your opinion on this. I've been engaged to this guy for almost 2 years now. I've known him since I was 9. And I went up to see him at work about a week and a half ago, and I walk into the back room, and he's kissing a friend of mine that he works with.
He's, like, making out, or is he just kissing her in a friendly way?
I didn't see any tongues or anything, but his hands were on her butt.
All right.
Perfectly healthy.
And I went...
That's my new joke answer for the show.
When I walk back, they're like, what in the hell is going on? And they pull away, you know, and she gets all flustered, and she basically walks out, and he's like, sorry, our emotions got a hold of us, you know. And
oh, boy.
I left him.
Good.
And he wanted me to take him back, you know, saying he's sorry, it was a mistake, and
How old is he?
He's 23.
Did I hear you say you were engaged to him?
Yes.
Oh, Shannon, don't. Just chalk this up to experiments. You got lots of time. This is the higher power doing you a service.
Wait a minute. He's 5 years, so when you were 9, he was 14?
He was 13.
And you were friends?
We were 4.5 years apart. He actually worked at a restaurant with my mother. His father had gotten him the job there because his father knew the owner. And I met him by going up there to see my mother.
Yeah, and when did you start dating? 2 years ago?
We started dating about 3.5 years ago.
When you were 15?
Uh-huh.
And he was?
20?
Was almost 20, yes.
Mm. What state do you live in?
I live in Georgia.
Yeah. Oh, so he's a little young for you. That seems a little dicey, 20 and 15. 5 years is no big deal. There's no big deal between 25 and 30.
Yeah.
But when a chick is 15, I mean, ninth grade, tenth grade.
When you were 15, would you have dated a 10-year-old?
No.
Oh, well,
But the point, though. It's not different. The point is that, yes, it's different.
It is different. Okay, 10-year-old, their maturity level is most guys that are the age of 10, they act like they're 2. Okay?
And then 2-year-olds act like zygotes, right? Yeah, like they're still in the fetus stage.
Morulas. Yeah.
But you're morulas.
You're young, and I think you got to get out and experience some things. And I think this is a tip of the iceberg thing. I mean, it's a case of, you know, what else has a guy done that you don't know about?
Yeah, you don't really understand how much of an idiot this guy is, and you're not a peer of his. He's a lot older than you are. It's hard to assess somebody that's this far outside of your peer age.
Right.
And he was an a-hole at 20, and he's still one at 25.
And it's absolutely amazing, because we don't even have to close one eye to picture this guy, right?
Yeah.
He's 20, he's cruising a 15-year-old, now he's 23, and he's making out with some chick while he's engaged in the back of the Arby's he works at. I mean,
he didn't say any more.
Do you need to know any more about this?
Let's find out where he works.
Yeah, dump
Come
the chump.
Where does he work?
All right. Where was she?
Five.
Shannon?
Yeah?
Where does he work?
Pizza Hut.
Ooh, I insulted him by going Arby's.
Actually, he has an Arby's right next to him.
Oh, I knew I had an Arby's feeling. He must have been closer to the Arby's when he was making out. I smelt melted cheese, and I thought it was coming from the Arby's. It must have been the pizza. I'm sorry. All right, Shannon.
Okay, thank you.
He's going nowhere.
Okay.
You'd be better off if you went lesbian tomorrow. You understand?
I've actually considered that.
Okay. Stop acting out.
Shannon's got a whole history there, too.
That's right. What a catch. Matt.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, you're 26.
Yes, I am.
What's going on?
I had a couple questions for PJ and Brian.
Go ahead, Matt.
For you guys, I'm interested in getting into the racing business, like the business and not a driver, at least at this point. Wonder if you had any advice for someone trying to break into the open wheel ranks. Card or one of the feeders like Atlantics or Lights or...
How old are you?
26.
What are you looking to do?
Right now, just about anything. I have a degree in sports management, basically, you know, business of sports. And just to get my foot in the door, I'm willing to do just about anything.
Somebody's going to have to set up PJ's buffet in his hospitality tent on Sunday,
aren't
they?
Especially with Adam around.
I'm hungry. I'm going on a fast right now for Sunday.
You know, at 26, time's not on your side for sure. It's a late, you know, like any sport, it's late to get started. But, I mean, there's a couple different possibilities. One would be to get a go-kart. There's professional organized kart racing, which is a good way to get started, get some experience without a lot of money, or to go to one of the racing schools and get a amateur racing license.
I'm especially interested in the business side.
Oh, the business side.
Yeah, I've been to Russell School, but I'm working right now.
That's a smarter move anyways.
Right. Yeah, that's right. All those car owners, they got all the money.
I'd love to do what you guys do, but it's probably not going to happen for me.
But it's not
what they're doing. What are the other jobs? I mean, I always think there's a guy who races the car and then a guy who works on the car. But there must be, how many guys are employed by, like, each team on the average?
We've got about 60 or so full-time people on our team. We're, I would say, small to medium-sized team. Two cars.
Yeah, same with us. We got two drivers, but when you say two drivers, that means four cars, and sometimes five because you have a test car, and it's 20 races. You know, three overseas, two in Canada, the rest in the United States, and the preparation and the technology. I mean, even though we're not as close to the high level of technology Formula One is,
right?
You know, it's still it takes a lot of manpower to race these things.
Well, and we don't just have mechanics. You get mechanics and engineers, of course, but I mean, we're a small business. We got secretaries, accountants. Yeah. We got a travel coordinator. Yeah. You know,
PR people.
You know, levels of administration. We got all the things that a small company does.
Chefs for Adam. You know, when he comes to hospitality.
That's right. Bartender for Adam when he comes to hospitality. I'll tell you, I had a great time last year. I was right down on the grid when the right before the race started. I mean, you know, when the cars were all lined up and the engines revving, and they had Joe Walsh sing the national anthem, which I thought was a strange call because, you know, Joe doesn't have the greatest, what you call it, pure a cappella type voice. You know what I mean? He's a little more quirkier, but this year I'm sure they'll yank someone else out of there. But I had the time of my life. Drew, you should come this year.
All right. When is it? This weekend.
This Sunday.
Sunday.
Yeah, you're not coming. You got to go to
Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
You got to go to Legoland with the kids, right?
Something like that. Some similar event.
Drag the kids out to the race.
Stacy.
Hi.
You're 25.
Right.
What's happening?
Basically, 2 years ago I met this guy. And we became friends or whatever, and just recently we got married so that he can become a citizen of the U.S. And this is about 3 months ago. And about a month later, about 2 months ago, I met this guy that I'm seeing now, and I haven't told him about our situation. Just it didn't really come up, and I didn't really think that it was important, like it was that serious yet.
Sorry.
And now I'm kind of thinking that I should tell him, but I don't know how.
Did he pay you? Did the other guy pay you to marry you?
No, he's actually a friend.
All right.
Are you living with him?
I would consider it like a roommate, kind of, yeah.
All right. So you don't have it's just a deal to dupe the government, right?
Right, basically.
All right, so the new guy's not going to care, is he?
Well, that's what I was kind of, I'm not really sure, like.
Well, listen, he knows you're not in love with the guy. You just did it so this guy could get his American status, right?
Right.
So the worst he's going to think is just that you're sort of the cheat.
There's something
but
more
why
here.
Wouldn't I have told him earlier?
Right, that's what I'm wondering.
Yeah.
Why?
Why didn't I?
Mm-hmm.
Because I never really thought it was, like, the relationship that I'm seeing with this guy now. Was that, like, serious for him to, like, for me to divulge?
All right. Well, then just tell him just like that. And don't worry about it. Where's this guy from?
He's from Argentina.
The guy you married?
He was a friend of yours. You were just helping out.
Basically, yeah.
Can you end it soon?
No. It probably will be at least another year.
You ever sleep with him?
Yes.
No.
Oh, come on. Oh, come on.
She hesitated on that one.
Let's do a little hypothetical here.
I'll be
Drew, pick anyone in the room, including yourself, and ask me if I've ever slept
Adam,
with
Adam, have you slept with Brian?
No.
DJ?
I don't know.
Come on,
I
got, you promised, Adam, you promised you wouldn't tell.
I got pretty loaded. He was showing me the trailer. You know, I got big 18-wheeler with bunk beds and everything and a VCR.
Well, Stacy, there is more going on here, and you live with the guy now. So I understand that it'll be something difficult to tell the guy, and it's going to be difficult for him to hear it.
Okay.
But you got to tell him.
Fine. We'll take a little break, and then we'll come back, talk a little more racing, talk a little more screwed-up teenager, all after this.
Loveline's phone number is 1-800-LOVE-191.
Loveline!
With Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. We'll be right back.
Can we talk here for a second?
They are treading water in a sea of retarded sexuality.
Loveline!
Exclusively on Tucson's New Rock. 92.1 KFMA.
Hey, it's the Love Line. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Chris Penn will be in here tomorrow night.
Chris Penn?
Yeah.
You ever had on the TV show?
Yeah. So he's a little drunk when he was on.
Oh, a little.
Well, just because he was drunk on TV, you don't think he'll be drunk on the radio, do you?
I shouldn't generalize like that.
I don't know what that sound was, Mike, but stop it.
Brian, you just had an appendectomy?
Well, yeah, about 4 weeks ago.
4 weeks ago.
Oh, Brian Herta and P.J. Jones are both here, by the way.
Brian had a happy 4 weeks ago.
Is that bad?
No, what an unpleasant thing.
Yeah, it sucks.
Did your... How, I mean, the dangerous part is if your appendix bursts, right? Or
I mean, these days it's the antibiotics are so good, it's pretty easy to contain. But yeah, it takes a lot longer, and there can be complications if it breaks. Yeah.
Well, how do you know? You get appendicitis? Is that what happens? Is that what leads into it?
Into the rupture?
No, it didn't. I had like a stomach ache for like 2.5 days, which I'm told is like an abnormally long time for it to not.
Nausea or pain?
Just pain, you know, and it wasn't getting better, and I was supposed to leave for a flight, so I went to the doctor's office, and they started running tests. Of course, you know, they didn't want to tell me anything, just running tests. Well, we got to run some more tests. They sent me to a gastroenterologist, thank you. Run some more tests. He sends me to the hospital. They make me drink 2 quarts of barium.
Oh, yeah, barium
enema. Oh, my God, this is, like, terrible. It's like drinking, I don't know what
it's like. Barium swallow or a barium enema?
No, not an enema, thank you, no, no.
Did you like one?
No, and...
Sure? So,
no, but okay. The enema might not have been as bad. I mean, trying to drink this stuff is horrible.
Two quarts?
Like, it's like drinking, you know, it's real heavy, like lead.
He's getting a small bowel series.
And so then they ran a... What are they, when you roll you in the machine?
CAT scan.
They ran a CAT scan on me. So, okay, you got appendicitis. We got to take your appendix out right away. I said, okay, great. And then they left me in the waiting room of the hospital for another 2.5-3 hours. So from the time they figured out, from the time I went to the first doctor until they actually took my appendix out, was like 12 hours.
Wow.
Yeah.
What a horrible day.
Yeah, and they're saying that normally, you know, it would have burst long before. And I'm thinking, well, I'm glad you told me after because,
did
you know.
Did it give me antibiotics?
No. No, it was terrible. I mean, I'm not really high on the whole stay of the...
The medical profession?
Well, at least the care I got. The care I got was terrible.
Did they tell you to get in your underwear and then wait around while they shot a round of golf?
No.
That's the usual.
No, they didn't do that. They didn't do that. But all's well that ends well.
Drew, it's why you need a general practitioner or an internist that knows you, who can shepherd you through all this. Otherwise, you're just adrift in a big system.
I'll
be your ombudsman.
I don't have a normal doctor because I just moved back out here. Right. And, you know, I knew I was in trouble. And the guy that came in to do the appendicitis, really nice doctor, but kid you not, he had to be about seven, you know, in his 60s. He's an older doctor. He did the appendectomy, and the next day, I telling him, you know, I race champ cars. I got to leave for Florida in a week and a half to go racing. He said, oh, yeah, driving a car is going to be no problem. As he's walking out, he turns to me and says, that's not strenuous, is it? And I'm thinking, okay, at this point, I can't even talk to the guy because he's got no concept of what I got to do in a week and a half.
You were driving a station wagon to Florida.
Yeah, he drove a car. He drove in that day. What was the big deal? So,
Says he drives like a champ. I don't know why he's bragging so much.
I think that's probably the biggest misconception about our sport. I think a lot of people really don't think that it's as physically demanding as it is. And we did a lot of testing this winter and the doctors put some oxygen sensors on measure our carbon monoxide exhaling, and then our heart rate and our blood sugar.
I'm going to jump in here. Carbon dioxide comes out of you,
yes,
right?
Dioxide.
Carbon monoxide.
Yeah, it comes out of the car. Yeah. Okay, I'm a little bad on the choice of words.
No, you're just a tailpipe away from being
right. I was hanging out of that tailpipe, but. Anyways, you know, they came back to, it's like equal to running a marathon or, you know, doing aerobics. Huh. And especially at a place like Long Beach or a Detroit Grand Prix, the ovals are more, not as physically, but it's more mentally stressing.
Were you able to do it?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. No, I train a lot anyways, so I think I was in good shape, really good shape before that happened. So I think that really helped me come back from it.
True.
We got good doctors that go travel with us. I mean, that's what I did. As soon as the guy left the room, I called up our regular cart doctors and said, hey, here's what's going on. Mm. The guy said, don't worry about it. Go home.
Good.
So I did.
We raced against each other a lot that last race, and I felt so bad for him. I let him go on the last lap, have the spot.
Yeah. That's very big of you.
He's a peach.
Megan,
mm-hmm.
You're 18.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Okay. I'm not sure if this is normal or not. My boyfriend, when he gets hard, he can crack his dick.
Yeah.
Not normal.
It's not normal?
Not uncommon, and doesn't mean anything.
Because I've never...
Let's see, about one out of four guys can do that.
Really?
Really?
How about in this room?
I can do it.
There you go.
Oh, really?
No, but Drew,
I take it back.
You knew I could do it. No, I haven't done it in years, though.
Because I've never seen anything like it.
Like, what, you mean like a knuckle kind of crack?
Yeah, it's just like you crack your fingers.
Wow.
No, me, I'm talking about cracking mine like a whip.
Does that go, you know, when your mother said, don't crack your knuckles, they'll get bigger? Does it work that way?
No.
There's a ligament there.
I'm here to tell you, no.
There's a ligament there. Yeah, Adam is living proof.
Thanks.
There's a ligament there that can crack. And
so it is normal?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. He has to have an erection, right?
No, he does it before. Hold on a second.
He has to have an erection.
Megan?
Mm-hmm.
Is that true?
No. I'm just saying he can get hard and then he can crack it.
What does the term erection mean to you?
Erection? You gonna come?
No, that means to get hard.
Oh,
oh no.
I'll tell you, after doing this show, here's what I like to do. I like to line up every health teacher in the country and just walk down the line like Patton and kick every one of them in the nuts. We got a guy.
Not just hell. How about English?
We had a guy call last night and he goes, The guy was like 23, right? And we have people calling thinking you can get pregnant from being in a jacuzzi that their cousin whacked off in last summer.
Or the guy that has stuff like large that. Testicles, something contagious, remember that?
Right. Like, he could catch something from this guy's large testicles. But the guy last night was great. He goes, sometimes when I'm masturbating and I sperm. What a state we're in.
We actually thought that was a step up.
It was, and then I started to make fun of him, and then I realized, hey, this is genius, because you take a crap, you spit, you pee comes out of you. I'm not sure about fart. I'm not sure if fart comes out of you, but you puke. You puke.
I got your point now.
You vomit. Vomit comes out.
Right. Now you sperm. Why should it be any different? Although when you cry, tears come out, which a woman brought up to me at the office today.
That's
when I was
nice.
Explaining sperming to her. Jenny.
Yeah.
Oh, maybe she was crying. That was it. Jenny, you're 26.
Yes, I am.
You're on with PJ and Brian Herta.
Hi, Brian. Hi, Dr. Adam. Hi, Drew.
Yeah. Hi.
Dr. Adam, listen to me.
That's good. It's fine.
I'm all nervous. Okay, here's my story. 3 weeks ago, I went to Florida for spring break. It was my first spring break. I had a wonderful time. Toward the end of my spring break, I met this guy, Matt. He's a doctor. And
he's 17 and a half. You didn't see
Doogie Howser?
You didn't think it was suspicious that Matt, the doctor, wants you to buy beer for him when you met him out front of the liquor store?
Yeah, I did, but...
All right, so Matt, the doctor.
Okay, so the first night we met, we just hung out and we talked a lot outside this bar. He was there with a bunch of guys for a bachelor party. And we just talked a whole lot. It was great. He gave us a ride home. He was a total gentleman. I just kissed him. Okay, so the next day, he called me when he got out of work, and we hung out for the whole day, went out for dinner, and it was my last night in Florida.
Where he lived in Florida, right there?
Yeah, he lived there. He's in his fourth year residency.
Okay,
so anyway, I spent the night with him, and we had wonderful, safe sex. It was great.
Yeah.
And then I left and went back home the next day, and I thought about him the whole time, of course, like all women do. And I just recently entered the single world after being with a man for 6 years and engaged and called it off because I just wasn't ready. It wasn't right. So anyway, I really like this guy. He's been calling me like every other day, and he wants to fly me down there. So I'm going to fly down there like in a few days, like next week, actually.
Yeah.
But everybody at work and everyone I tell, because I'm, like, really talkative and really open, I just talk to everybody about everything going on in my life.
Oh, really?
Of course, except for I didn't share the fact that I did sleep with this guy already.
Right. What's the problem?
It makes me feel, like, sleazy or cheap or something.
What's the problem?
Well, the problem is everybody's giving me such a hard time about it.
Ooh.
I mean, is it bad? Is this like, degrading? Because, like, I work with all men, and I don't want them to think bad of me or, like, I'm... Because they think that...
Hold on. Settle down now.
Okay.
Where are you calling from? Wisconsin?
No, Michigan.
We got into his can.
Yeah, yeah.
How are you supposed to meet somebody? I mean, if you don't, you know, you're in
Florida, the guy's staying in touch with you. He wants to see you again. It sounds perfect.
Yeah.
So you're exactly the same age. You both have careers.
He's going to be a doctor. He is a doctor.
He's a resident.
Yeah.
What's your residency in? This will be revealing.
He's an MD.
What's his residency in?
Oh, I don't know.
Oh, come on, Jenny. You slept with the guy.
Drew, what do you think? I don't know what the hell you do.
You know what my residency would be. Well, you know I'm an internist, right?
Well, they're like, all my friends, people that I work with, they're like, well, he just wants one thing.
He already got the one thing. He's going, beyond that.
Yeah, no.
So hell with that.
He's going to send you a ticket.
Jenna, you're fine.
Well, I'm going. Okay,
good
I'm going.
Good for you. Call us back.
I just wanted to call you guys because I've never had a real good reason to call you guys, and I think you're so cool and you crack me up.
Go. We support you.
I just wanted to call and just tell you so that you would tell me to fly down there.
You have our blessing.
Yeah, okay. Go down there and have sex with him. And, you know, here's your rap, though.
Okay.
You go, I've never done this before. Not the sex part, but the whole part about meeting the guy. There's nothing a guy likes. Guys love to bang chicks on the first or second date, but then the problem is the wheels start turning, and they go, yeah. I wonder how many... wait a minute. She could have been... I may not have been the... So you let them know that this was a total impulse move, because they were wearing so much Paco Rabanne.
Because of the attraction to him, it's just overwhelming. It's never happened.
Could not
before.
Stop herself.
Yes,
and then he'll eat that up.
He'll never think
about
it again.
He'll never ask it. Yeah, ask again.
That is good advice.
That is the wrap. We will be back.
You have 5 seconds.
Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
2.
Back in a minute.
1. Retarded sexuality.
Love life.
Exclusively on Tucson's New Rock. 92.1 KFMA.
Hey there, it's the Love Line. PJ Jones and Brian Hurd are both in here tonight. These guys race carts. Not go-karts, but in the kart series. And they'll be performing this Sunday at the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach, which I would say has got to be on its, 15, 20, I don't know what it is, 17 years? It's been a while.
75, I think, was the first
year. Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
No, but 84 was, I think, the first year for the Champ cars.
Right. They've swapped cars around a little bit, and... Now, Michael Andretti was winning. He won like 3 in a row like 2 years ago, right? Was it three, four years ago?
It's been real streaky.
Michael
won a bunch in a row, then Al Jr. won a bunch in a row, and then the last couple of years, Andretti won in a row. So it's been a real streaky race.
Yeah, it's. Did they normally work that way?
No. No.
There's not other races where guys win 3 years and another guy wins 2 years.
It happens, but this one's been the rule for some reason.
It's a different track this year, though. Configuration, yeah. Instead of turning right down at the end of Shoreline, we're going to turn left and go around the
corner. Go into the ocean?
Yes, I don't know. scare the fish.
Hopefully not.
Valerie.
Yes.
You're 24.
Yes.
What's going on?
Well, I was contemplating that myself. I'm not real sure. I guess my feelings are... overruling my body, I guess.
Valerie, just give us the question.
Well, I've been married 9 years now, and...
And you're 24?
Yeah.
How old is your husband?
He's 29.
Okay. He was 20, she was 15.
Pardon me?
Perfectly healthy. Go ahead.
I was 15.
Right.
He was 20.
Right.
Yeah.
I was warned that it was going to be a rocky road... because I was young. 2 years together, we split up, and we got back together. I guess my problem I'm having now is I love him very much.
Yeah. What is your question?
My question is, I can't control my sex drive.
What does that mean?
I don't know.
You're cheating?
No, not yet.
Well, then maybe you can control it.
Well, I've been trying.
Well, listen, anyone who's not having sex with any other people other than their husband can control their sex drive.
Well...
Wouldn't you say?
Yeah,
I can't control my killing, Drew. You want to ask me the next question?
No.
Well, who doesn't want to have sex?
He doesn't.
Oh, I was almost raised my hand for something, and I realized that it was for the listener. I see.
He doesn't want it nearly as much as I do.
Well, how much do you want it?
Well...
Get a good supply of batteries.
No, batteries don't work. I want the real thing. If I can't have the real thing,
How often do you want it?
Well, I would like it once a day, but I would settle for 3 times a week.
And where is he?
Thanks, Mike.
Huh?
What is he at?
He's upstairs in bed right now.
No, his number. What is he good for?
Honestly, he's good for about a minute.
Oh, Valerie.
Okay, Valerie.
I am not joking with you.
No, Valerie, you're not staying with us here.
Valerie, what? You want sex once a day.
How many times does he want it?
Sex.
If I get it out of him once a week, I'm lucky.
Okay, so what does he want?
I don't know what he wants. Okay. He won't talk to me.
But he's sort of shut down.
Exactly.
Okay. How long has that been going on for?
A good 2 years.
Is he on any medications or anything?
No.
You're mad at him, right?
Any drug use going on?
I'm angry.
Is he doing any drugs? Smoking pot?
No. No, we're an actually very clean family. Mm-hmm. We don't smoke. We don't drink.
Did you, I was going to do the joke where you go, God damn it, I left my cigarettes at the bar. But she didn't do the we don't cuss part, which would have made me say.
Yeah.
No, I didn't say that.
All right, well, Valerie, you have any kids?
Oh, yeah.
I've got two.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. Are they young?
An 8-year-old and a...
8-year-old.
5-year-old.
How are you 24 with an 8-year-old? I mean, that is bizarre to me.
Well... I'm a lot more mature for my age.
No, Valerie, please.
What?
8 years old. It's just bizarre to me that, you know, by the time you're 30,
do you live in a southern
your
state?
Kid's going to be 14 years old.
Pardon me?
No, listen, Valerie, listen to me. Mike, would you turn that damn hee-haw soundtrack off? Your husband and you are having some problems, right?
Yes.
You're very angry at him, and he's kind of withdrawing. He's shutting down. When guys don't want to have sex, if it's not because of some sort of substance problem, it's usually because they're sort of pulling back a little bit, retreating. He probably senses your anger, by the way, and is trying to stay out of your way. Why don't you two get Why don't you two get a little counseling on behalf of your kids?
Right. I have asked him to do that.
And what does he say?
No.
Why not?
Okay.
I think there could be somebody else. Yeah.
I mean, no.
I have thought that myself.
No, because if
they
if
need to overdo it,
you'd overdo it. You'd be getting flowers and oral sex three times a week.
No, he stopped giving me flowers because I caught on to when I got flowers, he had done something wrong.
Well, so he has a history of having done something wrong.
Yes.
What do you mean, with other women?
No, but something to royally piss me off where I've caught him lying about where he was.
Where was he?
I've never caught him, so I can't say for sure whether he's done it or not.
Where was he?
Well, he'd be like at strip bars. And he told me he went out to shoot pool with his friends. And his friends are really dumb, and they're really easy to trip up, and they always give him away.
Amazing. We figured he was hanging out with faculty from Harvard.
Yeah. But I'm with Adam. I think it's symptomatic of, you know, he's probably harboring something. You know, you guys are obviously having some problems, and he's probably pulling back. Well, that's what guys do. They run away.
There's a lot going on.
You guys get to just climb in your car and go out on the road. You're lucky.
So there's a ton going on here. We would not begin.
Valerie is very, very angry.
Yeah.
And believe me, the kids pick up on Mama being angry 24/7. It's a horrible environment. You could cut the tension with a knife. This guy's picking up on it, and like most stupid guys, or most any guys, they just want to avoid it. They see you coming down the hall, they turn into the bathroom and lock the door.
That's called hallway sex, isn't it?
They don't want to deal with it, you know? And this is how guys are. So you got to get him, you got to talk it out, but you not yell it out.
There's a lot going on.
It's never
going
to work. All right, we're all doomed. Drew's right. Steve?
Yes.
You're 19.
Yes. Thank you very much for taking my call. My issue today is with this relationship I've had with this guy who I met like 3 months ago about. And when I first saw him, like, basically I thought he was like the best thing I've ever seen, kind of, like that kind of thing. And somehow I got to like know him, I got to meet him, like he lives in my, where I live. And it ends up, we have this like very sick relationship now where he's completely straight, like completely. But it's like, all we talk about is sex, like constantly.
What kind of sex?
Well, he is obsessed with sex with girls. Like, he's obsessed with girls, like, constantly talks about girls. Anytime he sees one, he's like, I get with her, you know? Like, very, heterotypical, like, behavior.
Right.
Like, horny all the time. Talks about jerking off all the time. Oh, right. Like, every time.
And what's wrong with that?
No, it's fine.
Okay.
That's okay.
I'm sorry, man.
I know, it's your hobby, but, like, yeah. Like, yeah, when
no
I'm, like...
hobby. It's a way of life. It's a hobby.
he would say, that's like, you know, it's fine, because I talk about it, too, you know?
Okay. Like, well, you're gay, though, right?
Right, yeah.
Okay, then you like him.
Yes, a lot. And the weird thing is that, like, he knows I like him. It's, like, blindingly obvious. And, like, he does stuff, like, so that, kind of, like, to keep me liking him. It's really weird. Cause
like what? Give me an example.
Like, okay, today is exactly the reason I'm calling, because today was the most supreme example of all time. He just finished, like, masturbating or whatever, and he had, like, his cum on his boxer in his room. And so he's like...
God, I'm not living in that building.
He's like, do you want these or whatever?
This guy's just bizarre.
Yeah, well, all the talk about girls and everything, I mean, it sounds a little bit like he's overcompensating.
Covering.
I mean, you don't walk into a car dealership every day and talk to the sales guy about how much you like the car unless you know, thinking about taking it for a test drive, right?
Right, but I mean, seriously, I absolutely, there's no way I can see him being at all gay. Like, we have smoked up, we have drunk together, like,
Hey, like, Steve, nothing. The gay guy's tactic is you want to get high.
I don't want to, like, I would never take him in. I'm not the type of person who's going to, like, try to get him drunk and, like...
Oh, listen, the second he falls asleep, your hands, your thumb's in his ass.
That's right. Try to get the boy better, huh?
And he's much bigger than me. Like, I know there would be no way, like, I would even do it. We were, like...
All right, well, and Steve...
His gaydar tells him it's not.
Okay, so you understand he's not gay.
Right.
Well, stop...
Tormenting yourself.
Yeah.
I know, like, the thing is, okay, it's a screwed up relationship because...
It's not a relationship.
He
whacks off on his underpants and you go home and masturbate to him whacking off on his underpants. That is not a relationship.
I'm saying we're friends. Like, we go out all the time. Like, we're always going to parties and going to eat.
I don't know what's wrong with this guy, but Steve...
It's something.
You need to be the bigger man here because this guy doesn't sound like he's going to do it.
Right.
You need to just sort of curtail things with this guy. Just let him tail off a little bit.
See, every time I
play hard to get.
Every time I kind of try to get away from him. Every time I do that, he like does more stuff to like kind of like draw me back.
Yeah, well, don't let him.
It's like impossible for me not to.
Please, listen. Go find yourself a nice guy with some chaps or something, and just have a nice relationship, would you? Have you ever been with a guy?
Yeah, I mean...
Is your behind still intact?
Yeah, it is.
Huh?
Yeah.
It is? How come all the gay guys aren't getting in the ass anymore? Not what that, is going on?
Not that appealing to me. I don't know.
I'll tell you the one thing, the most important thing I learned from this show is about 65% of gay men do not get it in the ass.
It's about 80% probably.
What the hell? You're just blowing guys then. What the hell kind of life is that?
I can't imagine crawling up to some guy's big old hairy butt. Can you?
No, but, you know, I wouldn't want to blow him either. But once you're in, you know. I mean, that's part of the lifestyle. These guys should be fired. They should all be expelled from Gatum. All right, listen. You're wasting your time. You're obsessing. This is a height, you know.
Yeah, but
his
fantasy is that there's going to be a relationship there. And this other guy's getting off on the heightened sense, you know, sort of idealization the other guy has of him and all.
Right.
It's an awful situation. Just pull out.
Right. Hey, I wrote your initials in sperm, Steve, on my comforter. Come in here. I'm going to shine a black light on it.
Let's go to break, please.
Alex.
Please.
Alex? Oh, for Christ's
sake. Alex.
You are so lucky, Drew.
The caller who uses Alex as the name he wishes us to refer to him with.
The person who used the name Alex when they were speaking to our screener.
As opposed to their real name.
Who is 14 and who wanted to know if he ruined things by making out too early in a relationship. All right. For the world's dumbest caller. Alex, see, people call the show, they don't use their real name. And then it's but it's like you going to a bakery and not giving them your real name, and then you're just standing around while they keep yelling, Larry, and you're just standing around looking around
stage
for Larry.
Fright.
Yeah, you just forgot you were Larry, that's all. All right, we'll wake Alex up when we come back.
Loveline, be right back in a minute. Loveline on 92.1 KFMA.
Love
Loveline. We'll take a quick 10-second station identification. Girl slap a little more coffee on himself. And throw in your belly there. We'll be back with more Loveline in just 10 seconds.
This is Loveline on
radio
station.
Saludos, amigos.
This is a new rock alternative. 92.1
KFMA. The pain of lousy coffee. I don't feel like I'm on the radio.
True, you're such a tard. You know,
if the coffee tastes a little bit less than awful, I just doesn't feel right.
I buy milk for our coffee every once in a while, and Drew has such low self-esteem. He still uses that generic whitener that Westwood 2 provides. And it's the worst tasting crap in the world. I don't know why you do it to yourself, Drew. You must have a self-esteem
problem. It's some sort of zen of radio. Wherever I've gone, any radio station in the country,
no.
Worst coffee.
I know, but I just think you're a tardo for putting the powdered stuff in there when you could add the real milk. It makes a huge difference. Okay. P.J. Jones and Brian Herta are our guests tonight. They are race car drivers, and they're running in the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach, which is coming up this Sunday. They have... now, you guys, what day is it? So you'll be out there tomorrow practicing?
No, Friday.
Friday's the only practice day? Yeah. Is Saturday
Friday and Saturday, yeah. And they've got, like, the celebrity race on Saturday and...
A lot of events, you know. They got a lot of stuff going on. Atlantic race, an Indy Lights race.
Do they have... They don't have go-karts anymore, or
no,
do they?
No.
But they have Indy, did you say Formula Atlantic?
A big, like, trade show inside the convention center.
Right. Yeah,
it's just a happening event.
Yeah, it's great. Go down there. You can buy wax. I don't know if you can buy auto wax in any other place other than the Toyota Grand. Oh, that and Pep Boys Craig and play Chief, stuff like that. But when do you have a chance to get out to Pep Boys, Drew?
Never.
Never. Drew is such a pussy, everybody. He got a scuff in his car. And I said to him, now I want you guys to laugh it up big on this one. He had a scuff on the hood of his nice car. It was like somebody took the heel of a black shoe and just sort of rubbed it across it about 6 inches long. And that's basically, it didn't dent it or scratch it or anything, just a scuff. And
What were you doing on the top of your hood of your car?
He was dancing, celebrating. So I naturally, he didn't notice it, so I had to go point it out to him in the parking lot here, because I noticed, like, when Sherry, the phone screener, gets new tires, I come in and compliment her on it. I like to walk around the car like a border agent, you know, hold a mirror under it, have a look. See, I like to look at cars out in the parking lot. So I came in, and I said, Drew, you got a scuff on your hood. And he said, what? And he went out there, and he saw it, and he goes, going to have the guy take care of that. And I said, Drew, you don't have to, no one has to take care of that. Just get a little wax and, you know, rag and just, you know, rub it right out. I said, Drew, just get a little wax. When you get home tonight, get a little wax on the right. I don't have any wax. I said, wait a minute. Go into your garage and get some wax. I don't think I have wax. I said, Drew, how can you not have wax in your garage? Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Isn't that funny to you
guys?
Bizarre.
It's a doctor.
Hey,
I bet he's got a couple of sets of golf clubs.
Still in the car.
Oh, it is? Mike?
Yeah.
You're 16.
Hey, what's up, man?
What's happening?
Hey, my friend Shane wanted me to tell you he thinks you're fucking... Sorry.
Oh,
bro.
Mike.
Sorry about that. Okay, but...
Was that for me?
Yeah, Adam. Adam and Andrew, you guys are both awesome.
All right. Thanks.
All right. Well, I have two questions. One is about mushrooms. I wanted to know what they physically do to your body.
Other than your brain?
Yeah, well, like what they do, yeah. Like how they affect you.
They change levels of some of the chemicals in the brain that are responsible for emotions and visual experiences. And so it sort of alters the physiology in a way that wasn't supposed to be altered.
Yeah.
And there's something in the brain called excitotoxicity, which means that when you excite certain brain cells in a way that's not the way they're designed to be excited, they die.
Yeah.
And that's what we think happens with mushrooms.
So yeah. I don't know. Mushrooms aren't that bad, though, are they?
We don't know.
Now, people don't do enough of them to really figure it out.
That's basically true.
They get freaked out a couple of times, and I've done mushrooms like 3 times in my life, and I don't know how you could do it more than 10 times in a lifetime. I just don't. I mean, your side hurts the next day because you've been laughing because you're staring at your finger for too long.
Is it just the side effects that are bad, though?
Brain cell death, again.
Oh, yeah.
That isn't a problem?
Yeah.
Okay.
I understand.
Okay, Mike.
Okay, and then I have one more question, though. I was going out with this girl for 6 months, and I took one of my friends to a concert that I was supposed to take her to, and she broke up with me, she got all pissed off, and then today she tells me that she just wants to be friends and have sex, and I don't know what to do.
Oh, that's a dilemma.
Imagine,
yeah, imagine being 16 years old and just having a relationship based on sex. Oh, that's got to be confusing to the lad. Well, Mike asks a decent question because we know from doing this show that usually women at 16, 15, 16 that just want to strike up a sexual relationship are
got something going on.
A little less than stable.
Yeah.
On the other hand, you put a condom on, you have sex, right? He's 16. But he looked forward to being drawn into something.
Some chaos, yeah.
Because this is not going to be a freebie.
Yeah, but you're going to learn a valuable life lesson, and you're 16, and
yes.
It's two consenting people. What the heck?
Mm. I wish someone had taught me a valuable lesson when I was 16, you know, through sex. I learned everything I learned from mowing lawns, not mowing. All right. Natalie.
Yeah.
You're 25.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Well, I'm married. And I have three kids. Yeah. And I keep having these dreams about having sex with women. And I'm wondering if this is really normal because I don't know anyone else to talk to. That's why I called you guys.
Yeah. Yeah, so, but have you ever experienced a woman?
Well, you know, this is what's the weird part. It was my first sexual experience was with another woman, or a girl.
When you were 9?
I was little.
9.
Little.
And how little?
Huh?
How little?
5.
Wow.
Is that, how old was the girl?
You know, I think she was 5, too.
You know what? How do you even...
That's sexual abuse. That's what that, well, that's
child... A couple of 5-year-olds wrestling.
No, that is...
No, it once, was masturbation. I remember it clearly.
Natalie, once... The other one had been abused by an adult, I guarantee it. Yes.
Man,
oh, yes.
Drew has 3 triplets. They're all 6. So he has to believe... That anybody who engages in anything that he deems as deviant has to be like a stepdaughter of Hitler or one of the Manson family.
You mean there's no such thing as a horny 5-year-old?
Not that would be specifically sexual. An adult has to introduce that.
No.
What's interesting is...
this may be why you're all screwed up. There's something in here, your past here, that you want to tell me about.
I was
going to
say it.
Well, I'm not telling you anymore.
It's been... kind of evident that I have experienced some sexual abuse. It's kind of coming through.
All right, but other than the
sexual abuse.
Shut up, Drew.
No, I'm
shut
serious.
Drew's
I'm
mic off.
I'm confused about
Mike,
all
shut
this.
His mic
it's
off.
For women to have fantasies about having sex with other women.
Stay with the child. No, listen, Drew, your mic don't work. Listen to me.
Okay.
What happened other than the 5-year-old?
With what? With my life?
No, I mean sexually.
I don't know. I don't really know. I think there... My second experience was with another girl.
Oh, okay, so... you may be married to a woman, too, right now. You want to check?
No, I'm not.
Okay. Well, there's a lot of...
Wonderful husband.
A lot of women in your life for someone who's never been with a woman.
Be greater.
All right, well, listen. When was your second experience?
I'm trying to think how old I was.
Wait, you said you thought you might have been sexually abused before that 5-year-old experience?
Well, yeah, there's just been...
All right. Okay, Adam?
No, that's what I'm saying.
She
okay.
had been sexually abused before 5, and then she engaged in some sexual activity with another child.
No.
That's how it works.
No, the other
she
girl
just said
started
that.
It.
Natalie?
Yeah?
Do you believe that you were sexually abused before the age of 5?
I think so.
Did you initiate...
By who?
Stop it. Did you initiate the sexual contact with the other 5-year-old?
I don't remember. I mean,
okay,
geez,
see
that's a long time ago.
Thank God. And who sexually abused you, potentially?
I think it was my father.
Okay, well, then that's the real issue here.
And know that these sorts of traumatic experiences, particularly when they pertain to sexuality, get etched in your brain in a way that has to get acted out in adult life.
Right.
In a way that often becomes compulsive and uncontrollable. So right. this is
all
part
of it.
Got
a little that voice, too, reminds me of some trauma.
But you have got to get some treatment for this on behalf of the family you're trying to take care of, right?
I don't know where to go.
Well, go to any therapist. Just start with a general, plain old individual psychotherapy, okay?
Well, I was calling you about my abuse.
Natalie, it's all about your abuse. You're going to destroy your marriage.
You think so?
If you don't do something about this. You have children you're responsible for, and you, something happened to you that is now about to get acted out in your adult life.
You got 3 kids, right?
Yeah.
All right. Stop screwing around. We got more numbskulls raising kids in this country. It drives me insane. I mean, not that they even... mean any harm, but I mean, talk about a level of sophistication. You know what I mean? It's like, Maybe I was, I don't know, I may have been molested. Come to think of it, I think my dad molested me, yeah. But anyway, I want to talk about chicks, you know, in the here and now. It's talking to Natalie was like talking to someone who had about a third grader's understanding of psychology.
Yeah, talking to a five-year-old, because that's where she's stuck.
Right, but now with the three kids,
I know.
It's like, it scares me.
Yeah.
All right. I just hope they have cable. I just hope all kids just, someone just change them to a computer and that's it. I don't even want parents doing the parenting anymore because it's just, I want to let the computer do the parenting. I mean, I want the kids to, I want to like plug in some kind of jack into their belly button.
download them.
I'll talk to them all through from my bunker. That's right. I'll program all the kids. Wait a minute. You got a 1.5-year-old, don't you, Brian?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so I need to get her involved in the program. Tina.
Yes.
You're 17.
Right.
What's going on?
Okay. I was in this relationship with this guy for, like, 2 years. And we got out, like, I broke up with him. He, like, went crazy or whatever. He's, like, stealing and lying. And I was just, like, sick of his stuff, though. So I'm in this new relationship and stuff like that. And in the old relationship that I was in, I never got pains or anything. But now I'm starting to get, like, pains, like, when I'm having sex and stuff like that.
Wait, who is the new person?
I knew him when I was younger and stuff. He, like, just got back from the Navy.
But this is not a bad relationship. This one is working.
No, it's
and
not.
And what does your doctor say when they do a pelvic exam on you?
What they're doing, they've been running tests and stuff like that because, I have, like, the pap smear done and stuff. And it's just, like, abnormal. But it's, like, within normal limits.
How about putting
you
in
a colposcopy?
Yeah, I've heard of a colposcopy.
Yeah. They did one.
Drew, you went to school and everything? Yeah,
no, I work.
No, not you, but Drew did, right?
Yes.
Yeah, well, listen, wait a minute. I'm no doctor, but this guy just got back from the Navy. Now she feels a little irritation down below. Maybe he picked something up in Korea.
Well, no, I mean, like I had, like, all the STD tests and stuff. I'm like, I don't have anything.
You could still have salpingitis. You could have a tubal infection and not be able to detect it by the usual testing. And I would hope, first of all, have you had an ultrasound?
No, they just, like, it's just, like, early. It's like, I mean, I
hope they would do the ultrasound and make sure everything's structurally okay. And I would typically just go, the better part of valor is to go ahead and treat this with some antibiotics just in case there is a tubal infection. And it doesn't have to come from a sexually transmitted disease. They now think that other bacteria can get up there and cause
like when you're sleeping?
Well, they gave me these pills, doxycycline.
Well, that's exactly what you should have, doxycycline. Right. Doxycycline or doxycycline? Doxycycline, yeah.
Hey,
so they're treating you for salpingitis, basically.
Tina, how old is this Navy guy?
He's 20.
Okay.
They think you have an STD, basically, because that's the one, that's the antibiotic that covers that.
You know what we've been getting a lot of lately? A lot of people saying they knew each other when they were young and who are getting together
tonight.
In their 20s.
Tonight. Was just tonight.
No, it was last night too.
Right, yeah.
We haven't had that in a long time, but I haven't nailed anybody I knew when I was in, like, the fifth grade.
In fact, you brought that up last night. You said, isn't that be weird? Somebody you knew when you were six?
You know, you're on top of them. You've got hair all over you. You're sperming or whatever the hell you're doing. I mean, that's weird. I mean, outside of the family, of course. I mean, that's strange. I mean,
no brothers and sisters.
Yeah,
huh?
I mean, that doesn't count. But, I mean, you played tetherball with in the first or second grade. Now you're both hopped up on, malt liquor, and she's giving you a blowjob. That's weird. She's got, like, a tattoo. And
five kids.
Tongue piercing. Oh. Elena?
Hello?
You're 19.
Yes, I am.
You're on with PJ Jones and Brian Herta, both excellent race drivers.
Race drivers?
Well, race car drivers.
Please don't sound so excited about that.
Yeah, don't knock us until you try it.
Do you want to have a problem?
Yeah, hold on. I'm not sure about her attitude.
Yeah.
You know, our listeners are just, I bring this up at least once a week, they're just diabolical with their praise of our guests. I mean, it happens. It never fails, does it?
Yeah.
Like, I'll go,
hey, you ever watch her on TV?
No. you know, it's funny, too.
I don't think she was a race fan.
But no, they never even say just no. It's like, no, I have no idea who you are. And I hate that show. That's right.
No. Seriously, here's their answer. Like, I'll go, Hey, we got the star of Suddenly Susan in here. You ever watch the show? Yeah. What do you think of it? It's all right. You couldn't go, hey, I enjoy the show. Anyway, here's my question. Yeah. You know, like I'm going to come over there and test you on it. Like we're the Nielsens or something, for Christ's sake. They can never do it. You know, the latest, I'm trying to think, we had Alexandra Paul on here, and I think someone, I said, she was on Baywatch for like 5 years, and I said, hey, remember Baywatch? And the guy went, yeah. It's like, he didn't even go like, yeah.
It's just, you know, just our life's work. You know, since you're a kid, you dream of doing this, and you're working.
Elena's not impressed. Elena.
Yeah?
Got a couple of race car drivers on tonight. What do you think?
I love race car drivers.
Oh, much better.
So what was your question?
Yeah.
Right ahead.
Any day.
Okay. I'm kind of overweight. Not like that overweight, but I'm probably like, I don't know, like maybe 100 pounds more than my boyfriend is.
How much does he weigh?
Like 160.
All right. That's 475 pounds. I just did the math.
Radio math.
I said 100 pounds bigger than him.
Oh,
like
okay.
400.
Okay. He's 160. How tall is he?
He's 5'9".
Mm-hmm. And how old is he?
24.
Black guy?
No, he's white.
Huh?
He's white.
Mulatto? He's a white guy?
Yeah.
Okay. Playing a hunch.
So, we're like at the sexual stage of our relationship.
And right.
I'm a really big writer. Like, I love writing people, but I think that, like, it hurts them. Mm-hmm. And I've been talking to my friends, but they don't really know, like, how to help me or anything. But I'm wondering, like, what kind of positions we could do. Where, I mean, I don't want to hurt him.
Right.
Good for him.
Right.
So, what should I try?
All right, so you like to get on top.
Yeah, that's what I like to do.
But you don't want to hurt him because of the weight difference. Yeah, like a super heavyweight getting in there and just batting around the middleweight.
Okay, I'm not that bad.
Most men are 100 pounds heavier than women.
It works all right. Although we don't care whether they like it or not.
Minds are a little preoccupied.
Don't you think, though, you could get on top and sort of control yourself? I mean, you don't have to pound down with every inch of inertia, would you?
No, but, I mean, I just want to make sure, like, I'm making him feel good, not that I'm hurting him.
Well, he'll let you know.
Yeah, you'd know, I gotta think.
You think he'd say something? I mean, if he had any air in his lungs, he'd probably scream for help, right?
The wind out of him.
If he just squeeze every ounce out of him. Yeah, why don't you get on top? He'll like that.
Well, what do you think? There's like some other positions we could try?
Well, you could do wheelbarrow. Do I know? Listen, here's all I know. He can get on top of you, or you can get on top of him. Or you can, he can do like some doggy thing. Those are my only positions I know about.
I don't know, there's a book or something, what, 101 positions?
You can get the pop-up Kama Sutra where they, where you can really tell what's going on.
Yeah.
Do you have large breasts?
Yeah.
All right, well, you get on top.
That's the way it goes, though, isn't it? You end up trying out a bunch of different stuff, but you get your go-to positions, you know, you get your two or three favorites.
Yeah, you're like a pitcher who's got a good fastball, maybe experimenting with a knuckle or a
curveball
or something. But
bottom of the ninth, you're going fastball.
Yeah. Right, yes. you go for the bread and the butter. You don't screw around. And then you guys will work it out. God bless this guy. She sounds like a good time. All right, Elena, good luck with the young lad. And you might want to have him sign some sort of waiver or something before he gets in there. I mean, if tragedy should strike, you know what?
Release the liability.
Right, that could be manslaughter, right? All right, we'll take a little break. We'll be back.
I feel so liquidy.
Really? Why?
You're listening to Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. Loveline will be right back.
They're treading water in a sea of retarded sexuality.
Love Line. Exclusively on Tucson's New Rock, 92.1 KFMA.
This is Pamela Lee, and you're listening to Love Line with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Yes, you is. There we go.
Can you play number four for Adam?
Yeah. Do you have that queued up there, Mike?
Oh, he's got it there.
True. Well, hold on a second. PJ Jones and Brian Herta are both here. They are kart racers. You can find them Sunday in Long Beach at the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. Mike, you got it? Let's hear it. You know, it sounded pretty good to the end. It sounded a little unrealistic. Yeah. That was a fart CD that engineer Mike threw in here. It's called Pull My Finger, 99 tracks of flatulent sound effect. It's good, yeah. How many? You know, it's funny. There's 99. Like, you couldn't get by with 85 of fart sounds, you know? I mean, that's not going to cover it. You won't make it the weekend with 85 farts. You got to go 99. Thank you, Mike. Chad?
Yeah.
You're 15?
Yep.
What's going on?
What?
What do you want?
Oh, first of all, I want to get to see you guys. You're really cool. I think you work great together. And one other question. When is Offspring coming in next? Because they're like a really awesome band.
It's a fine question. You know, I called Dickie from the Boston's today to talk to him about, you know, I'm doing this TV show, and if you want to put music on your show, and you want like a Tom Jones song, about 20 seconds, $15,000. It's like, it's bizarre. You go, oh, wait a minute, we just want to do, we got to sing Happy Birthday. That's $30,000.
To sing Happy Birthday.
It's like, it's bizarre. I mean, there's just some song, like some riff or something, whatever. I'm not talking about the Beatles, you know. You're just going, yeah, and it's just coming into commercial. We just want something kind of cool, something whatever. $20,000. It's like, it's bizarre. So I called Dickie and I said, hey, we like some Boston songs. Why don't you let us use those and see what you can do? So we were talking to him, and he said he was going to go out with the Offspring real soon, the Boston and the Offspringians. So I said, that sounds like a good gig. So I don't know where the hell they're going to be. But Ann, where are the Offspring, and when are they coming back? Ann has no idea. So the answer to you, Chad, is sometime, but we don't know when.
Okay. I guess that'll do. Okay. The thing is, there's this girl at school, and a lot of her friends have been telling me, you know, she thinks I'm hot and all this kind of stuff. And she's been kind of flirting with me and everything. And, you know, she's really hot, you know. She's, you know, pretty good looking. And I want to ask her out, except there's a problem. My mom, she doesn't think that a person my age should be dating. She doesn't. She wants me to wait till I'm
27.
No, I'm 16. Till I'm 16. I'm actually not 15. I'm 14. But
how old is the girl?
She's 14 too.
You have to figure out relationships a little bit. I mean, you're not. It's not as though you're going to be having sex with her. You just wanted to date, and
a little finger, right?
What if you just sort of met at school social functions, that sort of thing? Can you get by with that?
There's not really anything like that. I only have one class with her, and that's not much.
Can't you guys go over to the sock hop or something on your way home? Is that what you're talking about, Drew? Like go over to Arnold's and have a knee high?
Hang out at the cafeteria or something like that?
Well, I mean, if I ask her out, I mean, I don't want her to expect something, you know, more than,
well,
like go to dinner or something.
When are you going to be 15?
September.
Year and a half before he's driving.
Oh, yeah. And what do you do if you go out with her? Who's going to drive? You guys, somebody got to get one of your folks to drive you?
Well, no, I wanted to kind of, because, like, my mom and my dad don't want me or my brother dating until we're 16. So
right.
I was thinking maybe, like, you know, ride our bikes or see how we're going to the beach with my friends or something and just.
Yeah. All right, listen, forget about your mom. Just ask her. Don't ask her out. Just ask her if you can sit next to her when you go at lunch break and just sit there and chat with her and see where it goes.
But he said going to the beach with his friends. Or, I mean, I think, you know,
sounds
hanging
good.
Out with friends and stuff, I mean, that's just hanging out. I think that's normal. It's natural.
Absolutely.
Should do that.
Yep.
Yeah, nothing wrong with that, although Drew's daughter's not going to be doing it.
Nope.
Well, you're not one of those dads that are going to stand at the front door with a shotgun, are you?
I would have to. She's going to be in the prison downstairs.
Let
me know, because I'm going to need the key a few years
later. Let me tell you how Drew...
Like me standing at the front door.
Drew's revving the engine, burning out on the lawn.
Someone told... Oh. Father of a daughter, also someone told me an interesting story. They said, the difference between having a daughter and a son is if you have a son, you only have to worry about one penis. If you have a daughter, you got to worry about all of them.
That's very true. Very true. And here's how Drew is a father. Here's how he's going to hear everything. Hey, we want to go with Paulina over to the beach. Drew's going to hear, gang rape. That's all you're gonna hear. We want to go to the carnival, gang rape. That's all you're ever going to hear. Everything is going to be, everything will be replaced by the word rape. Will it not, Drew? Beach will be replaced by rape, carnival rape, school rape. Everything will be rape, right?
Yep.
Maybe just locker in the closet. Yep.
First date guys that show up driving a van.
The Bondo all over the side. And the Uncle Henry a hooga horn.
little mattress in the back.
Well, waterbed. What do you mean mattress?
Chris,
you're 16.
Yeah, how's it going?
What's going on?
Not much. I actually just kind of wanted to talk to PJ and Brian.
All right.
Hey, Chris, how's it going?
It's going pretty
good.
Thank
God. Where have you been all night?
You guys have been pretty quiet.
Oh, they're talking. Leave them alone.
Yeah, so I just want to talk about other racers and kart, like Zanardi and Tracy. I just want to hear your opinions on those kind of guys. I mean, they go out there pretty hard, and they're definitely highly competitive, and I just wanted to see what your opinion was on them.
As opposed to...
Oh, you're all going out there hard, but I mean...
There's just different types of individuals, you know. Some are real thinkers and win a lot of races and I think everybody out there has a lot of talent, obviously, and some people harness it a little differently. And Zanardi was obviously very good, and in a lot of ways very lucky. And I mean, in order to run into that many cars and still make it to the finish was pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Paul, you know, is a great race driver. You know, he's just sometimes, he puts it in or sticks it in someplace where it really doesn't, you know, or shouldn't be, and I think he's getting better at it. You know, I think he's starting to, harness his emotions a little bit more. But, you know, when you're going week in and week out, you want to win so bad, and it's so competitive now. The last two races, it's more aggressive than I've ever seen it, and more competitive than I've ever seen it.
Yeah, definitely last season, too. That was pretty crazy.
Are you going to be down there, Chris, in Long Beach?
No, I wish I was, though. That'd be pretty sweet.
Where are you calling from?
Cupertino, California.
I was just up there yesterday.
Yeah, I know. That's what I also want to talk to you about, too.
What's that?
Is that, really kind of pissed me off. I missed you. You were at my school at Monta Vista.
Very cool school. Had a nice day.
Yeah, and...
A lot of nice kids.
Yeah,
Monta Vista, that's Spanish for, gay cowboy? What is Monta Vista mean?
Close there. Mountain View.
Oh, yeah, same thing.
Yeah, actually, Dr. Drew, you interviewed two of my friends.
Oh, no kidding. Who, Nick and Matt?
Yeah, Matt. And you actually, Emily.
Oh, yeah.
Piece of paper you signed.
Yeah.
That was me.
Oh, no kidding. Well, nice talk to
you. Well, wait a minute. You saw Drew then, right?
No,
Emily had me sign some stuff.
No. Where were you?
I got stuck in my Spanish class after school when I wanted to go talk to Drew.
What kind of school is this? A private school?
No, it's a public school, but it's in Cupertino, so the median income is 10 times higher than anywhere else in the country.
So it's a good school.
It's a really good school.
Yeah, it's highly competitive.
Yeah, a lot of good kids there.
All right, Chris.
I had a good time. Thanks for having me up there. I appreciate it.
No problem, dude.
All right, Chris.
Bye.
Well, he knew his way around the kart circuit. Hey, how do you guys, what do you guys have, a 5-speed? You have manual transmission?
6-speed.
Six-speed.
Sequential shift. Which is, it's like a motorcycle.
Right.
So the stick doesn't move side to side. It moves forward to downshift, backwards to upshift.
Right, right.
No skipping gears. You got to go through every gear.
Right, right. But, you know, you don't really skip gears. Well, I guess you would. You could go from, fifth down to third or something.
Well, that's the hardest thing. You come down, down a shoreline, mm-hmm. 185 miles an hour. And before it was a second or third gear turn, and you stop so quickly in these things now that a lot of times you used to switch gear. I mean, you used to skip gears to get down into the gear you wanted, and now you have to go boom, 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 boom. And it's really more of an issue when you go from sixth to second.
Right.
And sometimes you run out of time.
And now you guys, you don't shift. There's no shifting on the wheel like some Formula One cars. You do it with your hand.
Yeah,
and
still a gear shift.
You don't clutch it though.
No,
on the way up, but you clutch it on the way down.
No, you don't. We don't even have to lift off the gas.
You just clutch for the start.
No, clutch to get out of the pits.
Just get out of the pits.
Oh yeah, because the starts you're moving on the start.
Most of us drive two footed, so that would be left foot on the brake, right foot on the gas.
Wow, I like that. They really got those transmissions figured out. I mean, you don't have to hit the clutch. Just go right through it. And you don't have to get off the gas?
No.
To shift?
No. That's starting to come out in road cars now.
Yeah, they're doing these Tiptronic stuff where it's like on the wheel and all that kind of stuff, but it's sort of I think our kids will enjoy that. Drew, you're old school, right? Alex.
Yeah.
You're 14.
Yeah, I got disconnected last time, so it took me a while to call back and stuff. But I've had a girlfriend for like a year now.
Oh yeah, Alex, you're the guy we talked to or tried to talk to at the beginning of the show.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and it took me a while to get back through again.
Right.
I've had a girlfriend for a year, and lately she's been kind of avoiding me, and around our second, third date, we made out, and it was kind of my idea, and we make out occasionally, but we've been off and on as boyfriend and girlfriend.
Yeah.
And
thank God he got cut off the first time.
Yeah.
Oh, wait a minute. She's avoiding you, right?
Yeah, but
all right. Well, yeah.
I don't know if I was moving too fast or what, and I just spoiled it right away.
Well, why don't you just slow down a little and see what happens?
Yeah, because I've
Mike,
been,
there we go.
I've been
You know what? Look, there isn't really any spoiling. You know what I mean?
No, not really.
If anybody's into a relationship, they're into that person.
Quite hard to get.
And they either like them or don't. If they find out that it's not the person that they thought they were, or there's something about them they don't like, it's not about spoiling something, unless there's actually some sort of assault.
Yeah, it's amazing. I don't know if it's just a flat-out stupidity or total denial or whatever the hell you're in when you're 15, 16, hell, into your early 20s as a guy, but it's the last time I went over to her house, she shot at me with a crossbow.
Do you think she still likes me?
Yeah, maybe she's not interested. No. No, because 8 months ago we made out. Yeah. And then she told my friend she thought I was, yeah. But she's dating four guys now. Yeah, she's not interested now. No. I mean, guys are very thick that way. I don't know, what that is in the male biology and how that serves us, because I would go out, I would ask girls out, get stood up, and as long as they gave me a semi-reasonable answer, then I was just on to the next appointment.
But you
know what I mean?
You instantly recognize it in your friends' relationships, don't you? I mean, looking at somebody, it's so easy to look at somebody else and say, oh, she's blowing you off, man.
Yeah, I know. That's very true. We should all just monitor everyone else's relationships and not be in charge of our own. Eric.
Ryan, PJ, what up, fellas?
Hey, what's going on?
How are you?
Hey, I was asking my girlfriend about having a threesome. She agreed to it, surprisingly, but she said she wanted to pick the person. So I was like, all right, no big deal. And surprisingly, she said she wanted to be your sister because she said she trusts her sister and, you know, she wants to have control over the whole situation.
All right.
What's the problem?
Perfectly natural. Perfectly normal. Perfectly healthy.
Let's talk after the break.
All right. Hey, Eric?
Yes.
Hang on. We got to take a break.
All right.
Me and PJ got to pee. Okay?
Cool.
You understand? PJ's just a nickname. His real name is Robert. Just because he urinates all the time. Drew, do you have to ram the console with the chair? Do you have to ram it, or could you just push it up against it? Eric, hang on. All right?
Cool.
Okay. PJ Jones and Brian Herta are both here. We're talking about cars tonight. Eric wants a threesome, and it may be with his girlfriend's sister. We'll get into that after this.
This is Loveline.
Loveline will be right back.
Hey there, Loveline fans. PJ Jones and Brian Herta are both in here tonight. They have the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach, which is coming up this Sunday in the famous Long Beach. That's why they call it Long Beach. it's a good time for one and all out there, and it's kind of nice. Racing, at least this kind of racing, not the dirt oval track or dirt figure eight or something. This is like...
Hey, what's wrong with dirt?
Well, these are like, the people that show up at this race are, you know, it's like good-looking women and guys with money in their wallet and people driving cars and people who aren't afraid to spend $4 on a churro. That doesn't intimidate them, you know what I'm saying? It's good. It's a good atmosphere. It's by the beach. It's not smoggy. It's usually...
A lot of good-looking girls walking by.
Absolutely, and it was good. It was good weather last year, as I recall, and it'll probably.
It looks
be
like
the
we're
same.
Heading to some good stuff now, aren't we?
Oh, yeah. It's gonna be great this week. It rained Saturday last year, but Sunday was good.
Right. Yeah, it was nice. You get a nice beer buzz. You walk around the infield. A lot of fat guys and windbreakers that say Winston.
Marlo.
I think I was in there when Brian did a little speech to the.
Sponsors.
A little sponsor speech where he shows up and does a little gland handing. And
did you catch that?
Yeah.
Yeah, the dog and pony show.
Yeah, you got to go in there and kiss a little ass.
Get up, say hey.
That's why they pay us the big money.
This is what to look for today. It's easy to do. Last year, you know, I started on the pole, so it's easy to get up in front of everybody and say, oh, here's where we're starting. It's a lot harder when you're starting 18th and say, hey, we're going to get them today.
Right. Everybody's like, man, what are you smoking?
I predict a huge accident, a big pile up in front of
17
me.
17 cars.
I've already had two of those.
Now, as far as sponsorship goes on a car, you have, you know, your main sponsor, and then you have a whole bunch of smaller ones, right?
Yes.
And, I mean... What does that get you? What's a smaller sponsor? I mean, how much is, like, the smallest sponsor you have? What's that cost somebody?
And
it could be anywhere from...
Six figures.
I mean, you know, the budget really is, like, 10 to, you know, around 10 million, 12 million to run a car.
Right. You know but I mean? the lowest sponsor is 200 grand or...
Probably in that range.
And he gets, like, a sticker on the driver's seat or something?
Yeah. No,
Vendor tray. They get rights, you know. Like, a small sponsor for us would be, like, Champion Spark Plugs. It's a small decal on the car.
Right.
But then they run a bunch of ads showing the car saying, you know, here's a performance racing car running Champion Spark Plugs. So they don't spend a lot of money, but then they get to use it in the advertising. And everybody sees the ad and goes, oh, well, geez, if these champions are good enough for, you know, that's good enough for that car, ought to be good enough for my, you know,
family car.
Ford.
And are there any guys who just are literally buying space on the car and don't use it for anything else other than the space on the car for advertising?
Well, I think today it's a business out there.
Right.
I mean, they're trying to get business from other sponsors that are involved in the series, or they're doing it for intercorporate reasons, you know, to boost up maybe the morale or the competitiveness, or to bring some of their distributors or their customers out to the races.
It's mind-boggling to me. Like, if I had a business and I was spending, you know, $750,000 a year to sponsor a car, and what I got is I got our name on the wind wing of the car, you know, I'd be pissed off. I'd want the car on the weekends.
Yeah, but what if you generated $4 million worth of business companies that are involved?
I know it works, but I just can't figure it out. I'd be the world's worst boss.
But if you look,
you know,
walk down the pit lane, you see all those names on the cars.
Win on
not,
Sunday, sell on Monday.
Yeah.
Right. I know. What's the weirdest sponsor out there? Does, like, Massengale sponsor any cars?
There was
a douche.
Massengale was on a car.
No, there was.
Yes, it was. It was small. Yes, it was. Dennis Vitola drove the car, and a number of things. It was. I can't remember any of the other ones.
What a whore this Dennis Vitola is! It's just Massengale on the side of his car.
The Ganassi cars have dog chow on the car, you know.
There's not in our series, but they do. Playboy has a sponsorship on some cars, or Penthouse, one of them.
Yeah. It's one of the only cars that's lower just in the back.
Oh, yeah.
Let's go to calls, please.
Eric.
Yes.
You're 24.
The guy with the sister.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, it's not his sister, though. It's your girlfriend's sister.
So you're not
going
to do this, right?
I don't know. I'm thinking about it.
Oh, come on.
Well,
I think she's setting a trap for you. I mean, if he consents to this, she's going to go see you. You are a scumbag. You're out of here. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but you got to be kind of screwed up just to dream this one up if you're her. She's kind of screwed up, Eric.
Every man's dream.
Oh, no. Actually, she's a very, very smart girl. She graduated from Jacksonville University, you know, double majors, all that kind of crap.
Well, what about her sister? How's she?
But being smart and being screwed up are not the same thing.
Well, she's not really screwed up. I mean, she's an intelligent girl. She knows what she's doing.
Eric, again, intelligence has nothing to do with being screwed up or not screwed up.
Let me tell you about a guy named Ted Kaczynski.
If you do it, you probably won't go out with her for maybe 2 months. Two minutes after it happens, it'll be over.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. 2 minutes, maybe. If you bring a sister in, it's so bizarre.
The reason I don't want to do it, though, is, I'm deciding probably not to do it, is because her sister is a virgin. And
look, Eric, just don't do it. This is a total mess.
First of all, the sister won't do it.
I think this is something. Either your girlfriend has got really serious problems and you're not aware of it, or she's setting a trap for you.
Well, she's already talked to her sister about it, and her sister agreed to do it.
What? How old is her sister?
19.
So you are going to have sex with your girlfriend and your girlfriend's sister in front of your girlfriend, and your girlfriend's sister's a virgin?
Yes.
You don't find that peculiar?
A little.
Are you serious about your girlfriend?
We've been together for 4 years.
No. All right. Well, this is it. You go out with a bang, though, and you get to break a hymen along the way. Yeah. But Eric, this will be on your reel. You know that one where the one God reviews to see if you go downstairs.
This
would
be on the reel, boy.
Yeah. It'd be like, you did throw a little change into the bucket on your way to the airport, but here's more importantly.
Look at this one.
Oh, you flogged her with your penis. Oh, no. That's it. You're going down below. Virgin. Oh, no. That ain't even purgatory now. You're going down. Please. Tammy.
Yes.
You're 26.
Yes.
What's happening?
Well, my husband has really bad chronic headaches and really bad back, and he's not really helpful around the house or with the kids. And every time I bring up him getting professional help, either with his headaches or his back, he basically sidesteps it.
How old is he?
And he's 27.
How did he injure himself?
He had bacterial meningitis when in the military, and when he got out of a coma, he woke up with them. And it's never gone away.
What's bacterial meningitis?
Bacterial meningitis.
Oh, I thought you said backtrail.
Yeah.
No.
Oh. All right. So, well, that's legitimate, right?
Yeah, well, he goes to the VA to get help, but they're not.
These guys.
Listen, haven't really determined why he still has
headaches. I got to tell you, I think 90% of people have back pain. It's all psychosomatic. I really do. Well, as a matter of fact, 90% of people say they can't work can work. There's 10% who got burnt in a fire or something.
He can work. He's very good at his job.
What's he do?
He's an assistant manager at a restaurant.
All right. Well, then he should be able to work around the house a little.
Yeah. Well, that was my point. But
he's taking pain medicine, right?
Well, they put him on so much medication.
Right.
It's worked.
Well,
he
takes Vicodin and he takes Soma.
Yeah.
And he's strung out on pain meds.
Well, he actually is not taking any now because they don't do anything. And he's
taking nothing now?
No. He's very skeptical about taking medications because he did have a drug problem when he was younger, and he doesn't want to get hooked on anything.
Oh, okay.
Well, he shouldn't be using any of these things then.
Well, he's not then.
Well, he gets so fed up with the VA kind of just giving him more drugs and not really helping him.
Yeah.
And when I broach the subject about getting other help outside of the VA.
Well, how much help do you need? I mean, can you get a maid?
No, here's what he needs to do.
What?
He is not in recovery, is he?
No.
That's right. If an addict does not replace the drugs with recovery, they get all kinds of bizarre symptoms. They get depression and sleep disturbances and anxiety disorders and pain.
Drew, you do not trust anyone with a backache, do you? Or a headache?
Not calling our show.
Yeah, Drew, you don't. They're all...
Well, because the story is different. It's not... All right, you know, my husband fell off a bridge. He had to have 17 surgeries, and now he's got radiculopathic pain in his foot. It burns, and it hurts in the low back when he bends over. It's totally different than he's lying around all the time. He's got headaches. He's got real vague pain.
Right.
Pain. And I mean, he experiences the pain. Don't get me wrong. He is in pain. But addicts have a system called the pain reward cycle where when the brain learns if it actually causes you the experience of intense pain, you deliver the reward. You deliver the opiates.
Right.
So it entrenches that behavior of pain. And until that's broken with some sort of insight-oriented treatment like 12-step, that sort of thing, he's not getting anywhere. And he sounds depressed. That's why he's not having trouble functioning. And again, if you don't replace the drugs with some form of recovery, addicts do not do well. They get depressed. They have panic.
Do you have any insight at all on this topic? Do you have an opinion?
Not at all.
Thank you. John?
Yeah.
You're 18.
Yeah, I've been trying to get into racing for a long time, and I can't really do it because my family really has a thing against racing. I mean, they don't just not want me to do it. They think it's like a sin. And
Amish?
No, it's nothing like that. They just have this weird... It's beyond a pet peeve, but they have a real thing about racing.
Well, why?
Why?
What do you mean a sin?
Because John wants to get into it.
I'm going to die instantly, right, for one thing.
There you go.
Like, right. I've gone autocrossing a few times, and I've done really well with it. And I didn't tell them for a while, and then I finally let them see a video of it. And they just about, you know, crapped all over the place.
Let me tell you something about a guy named Racer X. His dad pops Racer. He wouldn't let him race. You know, Drew?
I'm listening.
But he took the car anyway, and he was winning the race until the very end, and then he crashed a car, and then Pops went chasing after him, and Speed was just a kid at the time, and he never showed his face in front of Pops again, but he went on to become a very good racer, although going under the title of Racer X. Yeah.
Get rid of the videos, change your name, go out there, go under an alias. Yeah, I mean,
you could throw a lot of statistics out. I mean, statistically, it is. I mean, racing is safer than driving on the freeway. I mean, driving here to the studio is the most dangerous thing PJ and I'll do all weekend. In a way, statistically, but probably if your parents are that dead set against it, then they're not gonna hear those things. Yeah. And you're 18. You're gonna have to decide for yourself if it's something you want to pursue and you want to do, then you should do it.
Right. All right. And, today, it seems like with all these, it seems like there's more and more of these schools popping up. And, I mean, hell, you can go run a NASCAR down in, like, Vegas and stuff. I mean, if you got enough money, you can get behind the wheel of anything these days, and go-karts and all that stuff. So,
the famous saying in racing is speed costs money, how fast you want to go.
That is true. True, how much is speed an ounce, you say? Okay. We'll be back.
The phone number for Loveline is 1-800-LOVE-191. Loveline, I'll be right back.
Hey. All right, that is it. Chris Penn in here tomorrow night, the biggest and drunkest of the Penn brothers. We'll have a good time with him. PJ, Brian, thank you very much. I'll see you guys Sunday, actually.
All right.
Everybody.
And Drew, too, with the kids.
Potentially. I would love to do it.
He won't be there.
No.
But you'll see me. We'll have a good time. We'll hang out in the hospitality.
It's an awesome race. You got to come out.
Sunday, Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. Everyone get out there. It's going to be beautiful. Have a good time. Support the guys. And until next time, this is Sam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Mommy! This has been Loveline. The views expressed on Loveline are not necessarily those of the staff, the management, or the sponsors of this radio station. And are probably not the views of Westwood One Entertainment. Loveline is produced by Ann Wilkins-Ingle. Now, please listen to this station longer.